どうした？ 揃ってからやったらいいな。あそこさ、この、そう、遠い目に座ったらあかんの。あそこ開けてた方がいいな。あかんのかな。いや、そこ、ここいいよね。うん、そこ座ったら。なんで。いや、僕見えんで。後ろに座ってるっていう雰囲気でやれっていう配置に変えたわけね。The title of the today's class is Life-Oriented Technology Development in Southeast Asia. And I'm Kono, Political Center for Southeast Asia Studies. Now, we are carrying out large-scale project called Global COE Program. Global COE Program.The title of the program is In Search of Sustainable Human Sphere in Asia and Africa. It's a very large scale and it's not only by the scholars of area studies. We also invite some scholars like food science, energy science to join us. So it covers not only natural science but also for social science and humanity.What we want to say in the Global COE program is in short this word, from production oriented to life oriented. From production oriented to life oriented. In Japanese, 生産から生存へ。生産から生存へ。Our understanding about the present society, global society, it is too much production oriented. It's good in a sense. So far, we achieved prosperity. so many goods now. We have so many services now. But at the same time, that is one of the causes of, for example, global warming, or in a sense, collapse of human relations. So now it's a time for us to reconsider. This one? Which one? Can you see? Okay. So we think that now is the time to reconsider the production-oriented approach and to modify it to life-oriented approach. Then, what is life-oriented? So far, in production-oriented approach, our target was bigger and more effective production. We should pay much more attention to sustainable production. What kind of life is ideal? It's economically rich life. Everybody wants to be richer. But in life-oriented, more secured life. Secured means, in Japanese, anzen anshin na kurasu. Secured, maybe much more important than rich. And in production-oriented approach, everybody try to be the winner. There is a competition. Once we won, we can be the winner. We can get much more income. But there is a winner, that means there is a loser. And the competition is the basis of the principle of the society. But now we have to think much win-win relations. And here, win, maybe a little bit gain. Not so large as we can say here, but win-win. Then win-win with whom? It can be with neighbors, between you and I. It can be over the generations, the present generation with the next generation. It can be between human society with ecosystem. So far, we deteriorate natural environment. That means we may win over the ecosystem. But that causes serious problem for us too. So we use ecosystem, but that intervention must be some positive, or at least not so serious negative impact to ecosystem. That is win-win situation. So now, in the Global Steering Program, what we are thinking is, what is life-oriented technologies? Actually, in the Global Steering Program, we are thinking about technology, of like institutions, like organizations, all things. But today, I just focus on technologies. So what is life-oriented technology? That is a key question to which we have to answer in the Global COE program. We started to consider this question nearly 2 years ago. And we have 2 years more. Now it's just on the halfway. and what we can say now? That is a big question for me. We don't have answer yet. We understand that now is the time for us to divert, convert production-oriented to life-oriented approach. But then, what is the technology necessary for life-oriented life? But so far, we reconsider technical innovation during the last several decades and found most of them are production oriented. One example is Green Revolution. Green Revolution, do you know? Green Revolution in Japanese, 緑の革命、緑の革命。向こうの声聞こえへん、大丈夫なんだよ。Green Revolution is a technology disseminated, developed and distributed in the 1960s. That is a technology in for agriculture.And they develop new cultivar, new variety of wheat and rice. These are the major food of the majority of the people in the world. And that is, how can I say? That is the technology which achieve higher productivity.Higher yield. But for that purpose, we need more fertilizer, chemical fertilizer, more pesticide, insecticide. In short, it is a kind of high input, high return. That is critical characteristics.Of the new technology provided by the Green Revolution. And it also needs good water conditions. So we have to develop irrigation systems, irrigation drainage systems. So that makes the food production much more effective. And during the last several decades, the population.In the tropics, jump up. How did we feed them? How did we provide enough amount of food for them? It's because of this revolution. We can develop new technology for agriculture. So even though population growth is very sharp, starvation, food shortage, it's not so serious for us.So in that sense, we have to appreciate the technology developed by Green Revolution. But this technology, in order to use this technology, in order to adopt this technology, farmers need a lot of money, a lot of investment. They have to develop their field.For better water conditions. They have to buy fertilizers to apply for the crop. So this technology is distributed only among the rich farmers, only among the advantageous areas. And what happened to the poor farmers?Or less advantageous areas. They cannot use these technologies. So the productivity gap become big and big. They become relatively poor and poor. this is good in a sense, but also it is true that by this technology, disparity among farmers becoming big and big. Okay. That is one of the production-oriented technology. Second, information technology. Now, I guess you every day you use internet, email, and if you cannot access to internet or email, you what will happen to you? I don't know. But and through internet, you can collect any information, any knowledge, which is indispensable for your life. So it's very convenient. It's changed your life. But how many people in the world can access to internet every day without paying? And I don't know it exactly, but now the information gap is becoming bigger and bigger. If you see only in Japanese societies, among Japanese people only, it seems that everybody are getting benefit from internet information technology equally. Yes, it must be true. There may be somebody who don't use internet, but it is not because they are not he is not able to do it, but he don't like it. But if we see the world, if we go to Southeast Asian countries, yeah, of course, still in urban cities like Singapore or Manila or Kuala Lumpur or Bangkok, everybody is using it. But once we go to rural areas, so many people has never touched a computer, never use, never access to the internet. And now, so the information gap is becoming bigger and bigger. And of course, I have to say that information technology is sometimes equally benefit, provide benefit to all the people. But in a sense, it is creating this big discrepancy, this big inequality or discrepancy among the people. Medical science. Medical science also. Now the average life time, life expectancy of Japanese people, female 88, 7 or 8, male 82 or 3. How come? One reason is that we are enjoying good medical service. So many new technologies are developed in the field of medical science. Now, if our blood tube is deteriorated, we can develop artificial tube and replace it with my organ. iPS cell may create something new organs for us. We can exchange our organ is now is becoming exchangeable. And but how can I say? this kind of medical service is available only the selected person, not all, not all. And of course, in the future, we may be able to, or everybody may be able to enjoy this kind of most advanced technologies. But so far, what we see now is some technical development provide benefit only for selected person, not all. And that is causing sometimes serious social conflict. You know that during the last several months in Bangkok, Thailand, there is a big movement against the present government. And that means there are so many background behind that movement. But one of the significant cause of that movement is serious social conflict between the rich and the poor among the Thai society. Okay. That is what we are thinking now. We have to, what our understanding is that now our technology development is so much production oriented. And we don't say that production oriented is bad. Production oriented technical innovation has a good aspect. But at the same time, we have to consider the weakness of production oriented technological development. And we also have to think about life oriented technical development. Today I want to use parallel bar growing as a material for the discussion. Parallel bar, gum. Do you know what is the material of rubber? It's a latex of para-rubber tree. Latex, 樹脂。木の汁やな。And actually there are two types of para-rubber growing technology in Southeast Asia. One is called rubber garden. The other is called rubber forest. Or sometimes we say garden type and forest type. Or rubber forest is sometimes called jungle rubber. This is rubber garden in Riau, Sumatra Island in Indonesia. This is rubber type. And this is my counterpart in Riau. He's a lecturer of Riau University. This is local farmer. He's a migrant from Java. And he developed about 2 hectares of rubber garden here. This is rubber tree. This is still young, maybe 2-3 years old. We cannot tap it yet. But you can see rubber trees are planted with regular spacing. This is rather matured rubber trees. And this is rubber garden type. And for rubber tree, they cut it with knife. And then white latex cut it, and next day they collect it. That is what they are doing. And one person take care 300 or 400 trees. Early in the morning, they visit the garden, cut it, and at the same time collect it. Or sometimes, once in 2 days. And they spend 3-4 hours to tap and collect rubber latex. So this is garden type rubber. You can see regular spacing, no weed, well maintained. This is forest type, rubber forest. These are mostly rubber trees. This organized, no irregular spacing, random. Some trees are big, some trees are small. That means some trees are old, some trees are young. No rule and regulations. Sometimes, several trees are located very nearby. Regular spacing is very effective for uniform growth of the trees. But here, many trees are just several centimeters spacing. But they are also using, you can see the tapping. So they are using these trees for collecting rubber. It's also forest type, rubber forest. It's now tapping. And you can see many, many weed. And you can also see some other trees also. So it's a not monoculture. Various trees comes out. Sometimes you can see local big trees. It's Soria. This one is very good Soria. This tree exists here even before the rubber garden was opened. They keep it because it's a good tree. It's good for timber. So they keep it. And whenever they need big amount of money, they can cut it, sell it. So this area is, yes, of course, rubber production is the main objective, but they can use this land for timber production also. I took this photo in rubber forest. If we see the sky from the forest, it's mostly covered with trees. That means it has big tree canopy. And that means in terms of, how can I say, utilization of solar energy, rubber forest is a rather effective ecosystem. Okay. So, okay, this is, I summarize the garden type and forest type. In case of garden type, they develop the land first. They clean all the trees first, and they plant seedlings of rubber simultaneously with regular spacing. It takes about 7 years before they start the tapping. So after 7 years, trees grow up. Now, and the tree can produce latex. And then, about 30 years continuously, the tree can produce latex. And then, they have to cut the trees. exactly one side. And there is no production here. And another production here. This Akaze system easy to take care. Easy to take care. All the trees, same age, regular spacing. So what tree needs, like they need nutrient, then they can provide fertilizer for all the trees. It's so they can manualize or standardize the care. Or if new variety is released, they can introduce that new variety simultaneously for all the trees when they replant trees. So this is rather, we can say that this is modern technology, effective technology, and productive technologies. Okay. This one, rubber forest. That is irregular spacing, mixed aging. At the beginning, the same. They clear the land, plant new trees. Anyway, they have to wait for 7 years. And after that, they can start production. The trees start production. But in some trees, the care is not so good. Then it dies. So if they don't do anything, the number of trees decrease. Number of trees decrease gradually. So the production gradually decrease, yes. But in case of forest rubber, there are some regeneration of trees. New trees come out automatically from the field because rubber seed fall down on the ground and some seed germinate. New trees comes out. Farmers don't kill it. They just maintain it. Or sometimes they select it. So even during this period, some trees are coming out naturally. And they take care to some extent. And after 7 years, the trees start production. And some trees can produce just 10 years or 15 years. But again, it died. But don't worry, another generation is always waiting. So here, production, and this is a kind of reproduction. Production and reproduction is, or we can say that reproduction process is embedded in production process. And so that is rubber forest ecosystem in a sense. It is much more complicated than this one. It's very simple. Monoculture, simple aging, but it's diverse and multiple aging. And so, okay, so the rubber forest, it's in rubber forest type, the initial and production stages, or in other words, production and reproduction stages coexist in the same system. And another important characteristic of rubber forest type is that here, in case of rubber garden, now we talk about farmers who depends on rubber production. This time, farmer doesn't have any income because they cannot, the tree cannot produce latex yet. Yes, this is full income. They have income. But again, this time, no income. 70 years. And again, income. So this gap is very severe time for farmers. What's happened in this case? It's this time the same. But after that, sometimes going up, sometimes some trees start producing, sometimes going to die, it doesn't matter. New trees come to the production stages, it's repeated. So he can find some trees which can produce latex at all the time. So that is continuity in ecosystem, not only in ecosystem, but also in the livelihood of the farmers also. So, okay, two types of paralava growing. I summarize. Rubber garden is regular spacing. Spacing is regular, but in rubber forest, irregular. Diversity, rubber garden, monoculture. But the rubber forest, it's mixed. Crop care, it's standardized in rubber garden, but less or no care in forest type. Weed, there is almost no weed in garden type, but many weed in forest type. And I didn't talk to you about this. And about farm size, the size of rubber farm. In case of rubber garden type, some farm is rather small, but some farm is rather big. But in case of forest type, mostly it's small type. And the management body also. In case of rubber garden, some are smallholders and some are estate owned by the big company. But in case of rubber forest, it's mostly for by smallholders. And the land productivity, production, it is higher, it is smaller, rather lower. Okay, so of course this is key point. We want to produce more latex from the unit size of land. So the はい。So the question evolution or adaptation? Evolution or adaptation? That is what we have to think. Evolution, 進化, adaptation, 適応. It's from this table. We may think this is lower, this is higher. So technically speaking, it is much more advanced technology. It's this is regular spacing means to utilize nutrient for solarization more effectively. culture can provide better environment for crop care, so they can use standardized technology for crop care. Wheat is a competitor with rubber trees, and no wheat must be much better. And this technology can be applied not only for large farmers, but also for small farms. This small scale. And this technology can be used from small holder to big landowners. So, in a sense, so it is true that most of the agricultural scientists think this technology is much more superior than this technology. And this technology is a kind of remnant of indigenous technologies. Remnant というか異物やな、残り。Remnant or anyway, this technology is going to disappear in the near future and all is replaced by new technology. That is generally said so. And but I want to raise a question whether this is evolution. Evolution means replace rubber forest is replaced by rubber garden. This is evolution. Or adaptation. Adaptation is rubber, we can say, is it a modernization, or we can say diversity. And so, in order to answer these questions, I visited Indonesia this year and last year. I observed rubber forest in three areas. One is Riau in Sumatra. Second is Jambi in Sumatra. This is rather lowland. This is hilly area. And another place is Sangau, West Kalimantan. And here we see both lowland and hilly areas. This is Riau. These are all rubber trees. And this also. This also. It's died, killed. It is, this tree is attacked by termite. Termite is shiroari. And first, I didn't know what it is. I thought that it is just died because of the old age. But I gradually recognized it's because of termite. This tree is not so old yet. But and it is producing latex. But if we carefully see the root zone, there is termite, and we are collecting the termite sample. And we ask farmers, and once the tree is attacked by termite, they are sure that within 1 or 2 years, the tree will die. And we ask them, why you don't protect trees from termite attack? They say that it's impossible. It's impossible. Of course, if they use very expensive chemicals, they may be able to. But it's It's not so popular there. And they say that it's about 5% of rubber trees in their park are attacked by termite every year. But they say that it doesn't matter. New trees are coming out. It is just replaced by new trees. They have this mechanism. So instead of using rather expensive chemicals, they keep it natural. This is also attacked by termite. This is very small trees. So termite attack is not depends on age of trees, even though it is young, even though it is old. It seems it's kind of random. This is in West Kalimantan. In West Kalimantan also, we also see many trees attacked by termite. It is in the tree. Once tree is attacked, termite eats bark of trees and make it nest. So it becomes like this. This is also termite. But still they are producing. But the production got low and low, and within 1-2 years, it will die. In case of termite, we found that termite is a kind of inevitable risk for rubber trees. The threat is big but not so serious. The number of trees attacked by termite just 5%. That means 95% trees can survive. If they have to protect their trees from termite, they have to apply chemicals for all the trees in order to save just 5% of trees. And then they think that, okay, 5%, let them eat. Let termite eat it. And instead, they will prepare the next generations simultaneously. That is their strategy. This is in West Kalimantan. This is seed of rubber trees. So it fall down on the ground surface. And new germination comes out. But we cannot eat it, but it's rather delicious for wild pig. There are so many wild pig in this area. And the wild pig loves to eat. And they like not only seed, but also young seedlings also. So, how can I say? Where there is wild pig, they cannot expect natural regeneration, natural germination, because wild pig eat all the seed. Wild pig, if some seed survive and new generation comes out, wild pig also eat it. So what they are doing? They have to, anyway, they need new generation every time. So they make a kind of nursery of rubber trees. That is new, another technology for them. They collect seed from the rubber forest and plant it in some plot, and they make fence. Not wild pig comes in to eat it. That is their strategy. This is in Zambia. And in some areas, there is no wild pig. So we can expect natural generations. But in some areas, particularly in hilly areas, there are many wild pigs in the forest. And wild pigs come to rubber forest to eat rubber seed and rubber seedlings. So they have to prepare this kind of things. And the seedlings also, if it is too small, it is eaten by wild pig. So they have to use this size of seedlings. If seedlings is grow up to this size, wild pig cannot eat it. And these seedlings are planted like this. These are rubbers. Because it's in the forest. And they grow it in the forest. And these are the planted seedlings. Okay. So far, I observed rubber forest in three areas: West Kalimantan, Riau, and Jambi. And what I found is that these are all rubber forests. What we found is that what farmers are thinking are quite different. What farmers are paying attention for taking care of their garden is quite different. In lowland of West Kalimantan and Riau, their main concern is termite. Termite is the biggest threat for them. And so what they are expecting is natural regeneration of rubber trees. They cannot protect trees from termite. In Jambi, it was wild pig. In case of Jambi, it is located near the mountain, near the hill. There are so many natural forests nearby, and there are so many wild pigs, and they come to eat seed and seedlings in the rubber garden. And again, they cannot protect wild pigs comes in, eat the seed and seedlings. What they can do is to grow up seedlings in the separated area, like nursery, and transplant it. In West Kalimantan, in the hilly area of West Kalimantan, fungus is Nantake, Kinya, Kabi, fungus, Kabi. Fungus is the biggest threat. It's something similar to termite. They cannot protect trees from fungus. And again, what they expect is natural regeneration. And so, what we found is that rubber forest technology is not standardized. Every place have different problems, different risks, and they try to overcome it by different approaches. That is one point. And the other point is that, but surprisingly, productivity of rubber, latex, are almost the same in all the areas. It's between 500 and 1,500 kg per hectare per year. There are no big differences. The condition is quite different. Like here, we talk about water conditions. Water is different. Soil is different. Threat, biggest risk is different. But the productivity almost the same. Farm size about 2 to 3 hectares, not much differences. So even though the set of technology may differ, but outcome may be almost quite similar. So I summarize rubber forest technology, how smallholders, not the scientists, not the, how can I say, large scale private sector, but the smallholders see. First, it is site specific. There are farmers are also concerned, has a concern that how to do it at their field. And second point, modern technology selectivity adopted. They have their own technologies, but they don't refuse to introduce new technologies. But they don't accept all the new technologies. They always try to introduce, but selectively, not all. Third, land productivity, not the dominant criterion of technology development. They have concern on productivity, yes, sure. But that is not the unique criteria for them to select technologies. And big diversity in productivity. As I said, that in Dambi, Riau, and West Kalimantan, I visited several farmers there. Among farmers in each area, there is a big differences in productivities. But if we see all the three areas, there is no significant differences in productivity. That means productivity doesn't depend on the macro conditions, such as the environmental and the socioeconomic settings, but depends on a kind of the household conditions or their specific field conditions. That is more significant than the macro conditions. ICRA, International Center for Research of Agroforestry, ICRAF. ICRAF, the headquarters is located in Bogor, Indonesia. It's an international center for agroforestry, including rubber. And it has an office in Jambi, Sumatra. And I will visit there because ICRAF has a more than 10 years research project of rubber growing, try to develop new rubber growing system, like it's a modified garden type system. Garden type system is a monoculture of rubber, but they try to mix it with some other trees or crops. And of course, ICRAF is an international center, so there are so many prominent scholars there. They think, it must be good model for the farmers to grow rubber. And Ratana-san, Ms. Ratana, she is a field officer She stay in Jambi for I don't know how many years, maybe 10 years, to introduce, to try to disseminate the rubber growing models to the local farmers here. What she said, we have worked here since 1995. We proposed comprehensive rubber garden systems. They call it RAS1 and RAS2. And set up 22 demonstration plots to disseminate the new technology to the local farmers. So, and we actually, I visited several demonstration plots. Yes, it's good, well managed. Looks very beautiful, seems high productivity. But neighboring farmers who has the field nearby demonstration farm are not interested in the technology. They just partially introduced some components of the technology, such as clone seedlings and chemical fertilizer application. Clone is duplication. Oh. So it's a high yielding seedlings. So clone seedlings, some farmers start to use it. Chemical fertilizers, some farmers start to use it. But other technologies, they just neglect it, even though ICRA tried to spread it into local farmers. And I have to say that the more than 10 years challenge of ICRA was not so successful. How can I say? We have to say that it's not because of ICRA, the scientists in ICRA is not so bad. Or you can say it's good. They are making a lot of effort, try to develop the most suitable systems, rubber growing systems, to the area, in the area. And they spend a lot of money to establish demonstration plot in the areas to show new technology to the farmers. And so their idea in terms of science, idea and the outreach method seems not so bad. But still, farmers don't accept it. And it's a serious question for us. We are always trying to new technologies based on our scientific understanding. But most cases, it is not accepted by local farmers. How come? How can we overcome this? Actually, I don't have question or answer to that question. But at this moment, I am thinking that our idea, the idea of scientists, is still production oriented. So we suppose that the optimization of production is the ultimate goal of the system development. So we try to introduce new cultivar, new input, like a new, how can I say, new water control, soil management, insect care, crop care. But farmers or local people may have more life oriented than scientists. And so there is a gap in ideas or principles between scholars, scientists, and local people. This gap may be one of the causes why the technologies developed by the scientists cannot spread into local societies. And you can say, then what the scientists are not seeing, what is lacking for the scientists when we develop new technologies? I don't know it, but one idea is that, okay, when at least when we think something about agricultural technology, we are sure that we are paying attention to ecology or global environment. This kind of consideration is now now indispensable. Yes, and in addition to local conditions. But I can say this side. Livelihood studies, we have to say still weak. Every farmer here, what we learn from the rubber study in Indonesia is that they have to survive. Or the farmer has to feed their family. That is the most important thing for them. Even so, they are very much concerned about what is the risk for their life. They try to minimize the risk, try to escape from the risk. That is their first concern, rather than maximizing the production. And that is a kind of livelihood studies. And their labor. Family labor, yes, okay. But if they have to employ other persons, it is called another risk for them. So far, we are thinking that agriculture is a science for agricultural production as well as, for example, ecology and environment. But actually, in the field, in the place where agricultural production is going on, it is also a part of livelihood of the farmers. And that perspective, we have to pay much more attention. And then we can adjust our technology development to rather, how can I say, life-oriented ones. As I said at the beginning, we have 2 years more in the Global COE program. I try to mix these two perspectives in the agriculture and the forestry technology studies. That is, hi, that's all this. こ向こう こっちが向こうこっちが質問どうしたらいいの？
あの向こうに適当に質問あれば。
ああこっちで初めてだよな。
こっ
ちいかがでしたか？わかった？Any question? question? 何でも。和田君、質問。あ、もう日本語で、まあ、つながってないからいいんちゃう。つながったら英語喋らなあかんけど。この価格は、あれ、リーマンショックの時にガーッと下がった。だけど、3分の2ぐらいまで下がった。だけど、その後、まあ、それほど下がってない。それは無理でしょう。いや、だから間伐するっていうのはある意味そのガーデンタイプにしていくっていうような感じじゃないな。で、でも間伐しようと思ったら労力もいるし、で、だから間伐にするっていうのはやっぱりある意味一本一本の木をきっちり育てて、その必ず確実に生産するっていう考え方や。でもフォレストタイプっていうのはいいんだよ、もう一本一本は。でも、もう死ぬやつがおったらどうぞ死んでくださいっていうことだよ。でも次また出てくるから大丈夫やっていう。それは僕熱帯と温帯の違いかもしれんと思う。やっぱりあの熱帯タオリンというのがもともと極めて多様なあの木で成り立ってるわけね。でだからそれだけその ある意味ストレスが小さくって、その環境下で生きられる種類木の種がもともと多いと、そういう中であまり手入れをしなかったらどういうことになるか。そう、弱肉強食やね。だから弱肉強食だからつながったか。Now 言うだけだほうがいいか。 Now I have one Japanese student make a question that what's the difference between forest and the garden type of rubber in terms of ecology? And I answered that the, in case of garden type, the basic strategy is try to protect individual trees. But in case of forest type,they don't pay attention to individual trees, but they have to maintain. Their strategy is to maintain a group of trees. That is a big difference between forest and garden type of rubber growing. これ何に先行するかすやったっけ？向こう。あそこそこ。あそこそこ。Any questions?こっちが変わってもいいよ。あ、あ、こっちの声は聞こえてるの？
あ、そう
です。
It seems like your microphone is muted.
どうぞ。と言われてます。 それは心の海の判断やよね。心の海の判断、うん、で今はまああのマイクロクレディットなんかが徐々に普及してるから、とにかく最初やるときはあのできない、あのそういうのを利用すると、まあ、スモールホルダーでもできないことはないと思う、うん、ただでも、まあ、彼らもそれも一つの問題で、彼らもやったことないわけね。ずっとフォレストでやってきてる人は、だからそれでだからいくらフなんかがあのいくらフやったのはモディファイドガーデンタイプみたいなもんやけど、そういうのをやってみたらって言って推薦してるんだけれど、なかなか入れてくれないと。え？グラフか？プロダクションや。プロダクションを増やしたい。プロダクションを増やすことによってより収入を増やして、まあ、経済発展をしてっていう、こうやっぱりそのストーリーを描くわけや。デベロップメントっていうのは、だからデベロップメントするためには収入を増やさなきゃ、そのためにはプロダクションを増やさなきゃ、そのためには今のシステムはダメだ、やっぱりこう改良していかなきゃ。それはフォレストタイプで改良じゃなくて、ガーデンタイプに変え、要するに、まあ、ガーデンタイプの思想を取り入れることであると。補助全体として収量を増やすためには一本一本の企業を増やさないかん、の収量を増やさないかん。ああ。いやでもな、あのなんで農業にとって収量増っていうのがやっぱり収入の増加につながると。でまあギャップのところは、そしたらギャップの間に別のものを作る方法とかいろいろ考えるわけや。その7年8年ギャップがあるわけね。だから最初のうちはゴムの木も小さいわけじゃない。だからそこで何か作物を作ると、そういうそのインタークロッピングの研究もあるわけ、いっぱいある。でだからそれでできますと。でだからす、えで、でもちろん出してる。補助する期間、
はい、何年
か。あれはイクラフはだから10年ぐらいじゃないかな最初の、うん、伝えようと思ったんや。だけどその期間が短かったからかどうかはちょっと分からへんよね。期間が短かったんか、やっぱり最初から方向性が間違ってたのか。で僕はやっぱりこう10年やってほとんどついてきてないっていうのは、期間が短かったっていうよりもやっぱり技術開発の方向性がどっかがやっぱり農民の考えてることとずれがあって、そうするとやっぱりあまりこっち向いてくれないと、そういうことではないかと思うけどね。でもな、ゴムで上げる必要はないかもしれない。他はあるかもしれない。農民はいろんなことできんねん。でも研究者の方は、まあ、ゴムを作る、ゴムの栽培に関する研究者って言ったら、もうそのことしか考えへんわけや。でそうなるとですね、やっぱズレが出てくるね。どうですか質問。 こういうのはな、ものすごく調べるの難しいね。聞くやろ、農家に。なんでイクラフのデモンストレーションプロットがあるわけや。でその隣でゴムやってる人おるわけや。なんでああいうふうにせえへんねん。こうするとですな、大体帰ってくるのやな。もうあんなんやったら、もうイノシシに食われるとかさ、あんなんやったら金かかるとかさ、あんなんやったら手間かかるとかさ、まあそういうこと言い張るわけや。でまあ、そうかな、そうでもないかなっていう感じなんや、聞いてる方は。で、なんでやったかっていうのは割と聞きやすいんやけど、なんでやれへんかってっていう、なんでやらなあかんねんってこう言われるわけやな、聞いたら。でだからそこで研究者っていうかフィールドワークする人の力量が問われるわけや。誰も教えてくれへんねん、なんで農家に広まらなかったか。でそこでだから私が考えているのは、イクラフのその提案というのは、ある意味そのゴムの収量を増やせる可能性はある、イクラの方が今やってるよりも。そやけどそれは例えばガーデンタイプやから、まあ30年経ったらパサッとみんな切らないかんわけや。そこギャップができると。それからまあきっちり手入れせなあかん。ところがその農家はいろいろ忙しいんだよ。ゴムの手入ればっかりしてるわけじゃないんだよ。他のことせなあかんとき、だから他のことせなあかんでも、いくらはまあゴムの優先しなさいってこう言うわけや。そんなもんできるかと思うと。で農家が忙しい理由は、ここで言うそのライブリフと下で言う図を見たらわかるわけや。みんなそれぞれ都合があんねん、事情が。でそのいやいや子供はどっか行ってて、誰かは病気で看病せなあかんとか、まあ、いろいろあるわけやな。そういうのやってると、そのイクラフが言うようにはできへんとかね。でだからその何もそので逆にゴムっていうのは、もしかしたらある程度もう確実に収入があったらそれで十分やと、それでもうボロ儲けせんでもええと思ってる。そしたらもう今のままこう続けてたらええやんと。わざわざ新しいことやって、うまいこといくかどうか分からへん技術を入れてですね、たくさん生産を上げようという方向に考えんでも、まあなんて言うたらいいな、タイ語で言うたらルアイルアイって言うんやけど、和田君ルアイルアイって分かるか？ルアイルアイって言うたらな、なんて言うんやな、ぼちぼちやってたらええ、ぼちぼちっていう京都弁会のあれ、大阪、ぼちぼちやってたらええんであって、そんな感じはある。で なんていうかな、やっぱりそれここで勝負やっていう時にはオプティマイズして最適化していろんなことやって考えていかなきゃあかんねんけれど、人生あるいは生活っていうのはこう勝負せんでもええ場面がいっぱいあるわけね。で、まあ、そこは、まあ、ある意味適当にやってたらええと、7分目8分目ぐらいの力でやってたらええと。でないと勝負のところ力入れへん。でゴムは少なくともこのフォレストタイプのゴムっていうのは勝負のゴムではないんだよ。わかるかな。でもね、僕アジアの農業はどうも絶対的にそうやっていう感じを持ってるね。これゴムのこと言ってるけど、今日例えば日本の農業だってそういうもんかもしれん。あれで勝負してないんだよみんな。まあ、ゴムの例えば米作りもあるけど、息子は役場へ働きに行ってると。あるいはまあこれまあこの野菜作って、まあ近所の人にもあげて親類にも送って、それでええやんと、まあ楽しみやと。そういうのも勝負の、そのどうも完全に勝負のための農業ではないと。 で研究者の方はもう勝負であるということを前提に研究を進めるからね、どうしても意識にずれがある。いい？アジアの農業がなぜそうなのか、決定的にファームサイズなんや、経営規模なんや。日本の経営規模は1ヘクタール、もう中国とかベトナム行ったらもう中国とかベトナム行ったらもっと小さい、東アジアは特に小さい、タイでも2ヘクタール、インドネシアでもそのぐらいで、だからアメリカとかオーストラリアとかに比べると100分の1ぐらいや。グローバリゼーションが進んでいったらもうどうしようもなく勝負できないんだよ。でもね、それでもやっぱり残ってるっていう事実をやっぱ考えなあかんねん。ね、やっぱりそれはずっとなくなれへんと思うわ。これやっぱり完全に勝負、完全にマーケットがこうどこでも同じように圧力になっていって、どこでも同じようなマーケットをシェアして、そこで勝負に出たら絶対負けるで。だけど、なんか違うアイデアを持ち込むことによって残る可能性ある。あるいは違うアイデアを持ち込むよって、じゃあその勝負ではない農業がもっとこう成熟化していく可能性がある。その農業発展の方向をこうプロダクションばっかりザーッと見ていったら、それはもう最終的にアメリカとかオーストラリアがガーッと勝負勝つんだよ。そうじゃなくって、こうもっといろんな生きる道がありますよっていうことを示すと、でそっちの方向へもいろんな技術革新をしていけますよっていうようなことを示すと、いろんな形で農業が、農業っていうか、まあ、農業だけじゃないと思うんだけれど、まあ、農業が持続して、それはやっぱり全体としてね、きっといい方向へ行くと思う。さて他よろしいですか。はい、いいか、いいな。はい、これでは終わりにしましょう。あ、なんか聞こえてるの？あ、
聞こえてますけど、向こうから聞こえないんです。
あ、そうか。なんでマイク消されてんねや。
向こうのテレカの人が授業中やからと思って、マイク消したまんま、その後の音にして
る。ハロー。Can you listen to me? I'm sorry, but I cannot listen to you.
Your side, the microphone is muted for a while.
Okay. So I cannot accept your questions today. Oh, 来たよ。Okay. Do you have any question? Okay.
If you have any question, just send in some questions through your the tutor to the course side, please. Thank you.
Okay. See you. And next week or night, you know, you're not going to attend. And I have an announcement.Next week, we don't have class. Next week, we don't have no class. So the next lecture is on 7th June. Oh, pardon? Okay. はい。